Jew was to go out on the temple and he was to blow a trumpet. It was called a shofar. When the moon was full, he went out and he blew that trumpet to show the people living in Jerusalem or in that area that it signified the beginning of a new month. They have uncovered shofars all over Israel, all over Israel. This is probably one of the nicest archaeological finds that they've discovered. They have actually in stone a picture of King Jehu right here on this obelisk, this black obelisk, prostrating or bowing down before the king of Assyria, mentioned in Isaiah 37:29, and you can read that whole story in 2 Kings 9:30. Moses prophesied when he took Israel out of Egypt that if they were not obedient to God, that a nation, a pagan nation, would come there and would carry them away with hooks in their mouth and in their jaws and in their nose, mentioned in 2 Kings 19:28. That's 800 years before Israel was even in the promised land. That's exactly what history is showing us has happened. There's a lot of things like the Hezekiah stone. Hezekiah, this is a nicer picture of King Jehu prostrating. He's right here. And his nose, if you look at it carefully, is all bloated out. Archaeology makes the Bible real. This is one of the few objects recovered from the time of Solomon in the temple. And it's a jar. And on the jar, it says this: for the house of Yahweh, holy to the priests. It's just like the Bible says. There was a temple, there was a priesthood. That's what that proves. Somebody says, well, I have a hard time believing the stories in the Bible. In Acts 21:27, it says this: and when the 7 days were almost ended, the Jews were in Asia, and they saw him, Paul. He was in the temple, and he stirred up all the people, and they were crying, watch, this is the man, Paul, that teaches all men everywhere against what we believe about Moses and the law and this holy temple. And further, he brought Greeks also in the temple, and he has polluted this holy place. This is a stone tablet that they've uncovered that would hang above a temple door. And it says Gentiles were forbidden to come in. Jerusalem temple inscription warning Gentiles against coming in to the holy temple. The Bible says that they were not supposed to do that. Jews were not allowed to invite Gentiles into the temple. And this is a stone tablet that they've uncovered in Jerusalem that proves just that.
Publisher Larry Williams meant business when he decided he wanted Ed Davis to sit for a lie detector test.
I went to Albuquerque, New Mexico, and hired a top polygraph expert with about 15 years of experience on the police force. I told him the Ed Davis story, and he said, Larry, give me half an hour with this guy and I'll break him. After two real intense hours, the polygraph expert came out and said, Larry, I can't tell you what mountain Ed Davis was on. I can't tell you if it was Noah's Ark, but I'll tell you this. Ed Davis saw a boat, and Ed Davis is not lying.
I noticed 100 or 200 feet away, there was building type of structure, definitely made of wood. It shouldn't be there, just 1,000 or 2,000 feet below the summit. It almost looked like a captain's cabin. I immediately took my camera and shot pictures. You can see straight flat beams and such. Definitely appears man-made structure.
In an August 1990 helicopter expedition around Mount Ararat, we flew over the glacier on the northeast face of the mountain. At that time, we took this photograph of the rectangular object we believe to be the Ark of Noah.
Now we're seeing a computer image of the primary object identified by satellite. As we enhance the computer image of this object, we can see that the object is rectangular in shape. Here, this is the outline, and the object extends over a ledge. In my opinion, this is clearly a man-made object.
They're at the Strategic Air Command, our secret documents right now, which have pictures of Noah's Ark. They're even labeled Noah's Ark on the picture.
We know our government has photos and satellite imagery of that area of Noah's Ark. However, they probably won't want to release that because when they do, they'll also disclose just how good our spy technology has become.
It is at TASC that we will continue our search for the Ark at locations pinpointed by satellite. In our animation model, we're approaching Mount Ararat from a couple of hundred miles away. We see Little Ararat in the foreground, and as we approach the two mountains, we're setting our course to fly between them as we go into a circular flight path around Mount Ararat. The animation clearly shows the finger glaciers on the mountain and the deep scar of the Ahura Gorge on the north side, above which the Ark sightings have occurred. The Ahura Gorge is an awesome sight of sheer cliffs all the way up to the Ararat snow line, which continues upward to Ararat's multiple summit peaks. Coming back to the Ahura Gorge across the Abish glaciers, we're going to examine three locations where parts of the Ark have been pinpointed by satellite as well as by eyewitnesses to determine if we can obtain a better visual perspective of the sites. First, we're going to look in this fishhook area on the eastern plateau where Ray Anderson believes the larger piece of the Ark is located. Moving down from about an 11 position on a clock face to a 5 position, we're directly over the site pinpointed by the SPOT satellite and depicted in photos taken on three different successful Ark expeditions.
I had a call last week from a guy from Mexico, and he said, we got talking, and we were talking about stuff on eBay, and then I brought him right to the Bible. Do you believe in Jesus? And he said, no. He said, do you believe the stories in the Bible? He said, some of them. He said to me, Paul, I believe in Paul. Paul started Christianity. So I said to him, I said this. Well, if Paul started Christianity, was he in it for money, personal comfort, the enjoyment of it all? Not at all. He already had that as a Jewish leader. He was a Jewish leader. He had the money, the glory of being popular, the personal comforts of home. Why would he give all that up? To be beaten, starved, robbed, made fun of. The Bible says he was stoned. The Bible says that he was in shipwreck. The Bible says he had nothing but a suffering life. I said to the guy, why would Paul do that? Would you? I wouldn't do that. Unless, of course, he sought the Lord of glory on his way to kill Christians. Something happened to him to say, no, I don't need a Lexus, a high-rise apartment with beautiful balcony overlooking the bay. I would much rather go straight to jail and suffer and hurt and starve. Who would do that? Obviously a man who saw Jesus talking to him. Paul said, who art thou, Lord? And Jesus said, I'm the one you're crucifying. I'm the one you're persecuting. Jesus, you're kicking against the thorns. Yay. Why would he change? Same thing with the apostles. I have a list in my Bible about the apostles died, and it's just an absolute nightmare, right? Matthew preached in Egypt and in Ethiopia, and he was martyred with a spear. He was speared in the city of Nadaba in Ethiopia in AD 66. John the Beloved was the only one that died of old age. James, the son of Alphaeus. There are two views concerning his death in history. According to the first, he was beaten and stoned to death by the Jews at the age of 94 and finally had his brains dashed out with a fuller's club. A fuller's club is a club you would use to do laundry with. The second version says that he was crucified in Persia. Andrew, in a small book written 200 years after Jesus died, said that he was crucified at Patras. He suffered on the cross for 2 days, buddy. 2 days. Mark was martyred in Alexandria around AD 68 on the Sunday of the 24th of April. Pagans seized him as he was preaching. They tied his feet with cords and they dragged him about the rocky streets as pieces of flesh were scattered.